Space, the final frontier. Man has been traveling here since the 60s. All of them brave voyagers, highly trained astronauts, not everyday people, until now. Our mission, to take ordinary members of the public, put them through a rigorous training regime on an isolated Russian military base, and then blast them off into space. Or so they'll think. Unbeknownst to them, they'll never actually leave UK soil. The scene is set. The countdown to launch has begun. Will the contestants even want to go into space? And if they do, will they fall for the biggest practical joke in television history? We're about to find out in Space Cadets. Hello and welcome to Space Cadets. It's space, Jim, but not as you know it. So what are we trying to achieve here? We have a two-part mission statement. Part one, we must convince a group of people that a large field a stone's throw from Ipswich is in fact a Russian space training facility. Part two, we must convince this same group of people we're going to put them in a shuttle, blast them into space for 5 days, where they'll make history as Britain's first televised space tourists. When in fact, they will be in this high-tech shuttle simulator based on genuine NASA blueprints in this aircraft hangar here in that same field near Ipswich. Now, if they last the full 5-day mission without rumbling us, they'll each walk away with a bundle of cash. This is the most elaborate and expensive hoax in British TV history. So what could possibly go wrong? Well, to be frank with you, pretty much everything. But don't panic. If the whole ruse is rumbled, there is a plan two in place which cannot fail. 10 episodes of Jamie Oliver's School Dinners. He came to the rescue of our children's health, and he's on 24-hour standby for us. So, as you can imagine, it's been vital that every detail has been covered, and in tonight's show, you'll be getting a behind-the-scenes look at the extraordinary time and effort that has gone into making sure this cosmic adventure succeeds. The whole project began back in April and was labelled top secret. If any information about the programme got out, then the ruse would have been ruined and the whole thing cancelled. So everyone working on the show signed up without knowing what it was about. Fake shows were invented to throw the press off the scent. Contestants applied to shows that didn't even exist, and actors auditioned for roles without knowing what parts they were playing. So back to task one. Establishing a believable Russian space facility right here near Ipswich. Star City. The Russian base that has trained every cosmonaut to blast into space. We had to replicate this facility to stand any chance of convincing our cadets they were at a real space camp. Was a tough task, but in the heart of the English countryside, we found just what we needed, a decommissioned military base from the Cold War. As you can see, there were similarities, but the producers believed their site looked better than the Russians. Job done. The site was packed with all sorts of interesting buildings, but it needed to be transformed from a derelict airbase into a convincing launch site for a space shuttle. There were four major areas that needed a complete revamp. This rundown building needed to become the barracks, where our space cadets would eat, sleep, and spend their spare time. The cadets would receive their training in the missile-proof building that used to be the base headquarters. The interior needed to transform into a Russian lecture room where our cadets could learn how to become space tourists. Mission Control, the nerve center of the operation. This is the real deal. At the height of the Cold War, a nuclear strike could have been launched from here in 5 minutes. The cadets will see this area only once, when it will be filled with actors dressed as flight engineers and mission specialists, who they believe are controlling their mission. Finally, this old aircraft hangar, previously used to test fighter planes, would need to become, well, space. It's in here our shuttle will be assembled. Our cadets will enter it through the tunnel once used to muffle the noise from the jet engines. This area needed the most work, as it's in here our cadets will need to totally believe they're boarding a shuttle to blast into space for a five-day mission. 3 square miles of an old military base in the English countryside to turn into a Russian space camp. Tricky, or as the Russians say, tricksky. So, with a little slice of Russia under construction in Suffolk, it was time to find some space cadets, hence the title. Yeah. Listen, lads, I know I said it's good to mutter and stuff for the realistic we're working kind of thing, but that's a bit too much. So you need some wannabe astronauts. How do you do it? First, you place a pretty vague ad in the press. Of those who applied, we invited the top 100 to London. Remember, at this point, they have no idea what the show is all about. Nice. Hold on, you look interesting. Who are you?
My full name is Jonathan Edward Sidney Harris VII, and I am a lord.
I say. Lord John certainly has the confidence. What about the rest of you?
When people want a good night out, I'm the person they phone. And when I turn up, immediately the smiles on the faces turn up and people are like, right, he's here, let's get on with it now.
People follow a lot, people can't make decisions for themselves, but with me, you see, I can do everything, you know, I'm a leader.
I always try and take the lead. I kind of always initiate things rather than just wait for it to happen.
My teeth are bent, they've done these front two, they've bent, and my feet are size 12. And it's true what they say.
What is it about me that the public would like to see? What is it about me that the public would like to see? They are. The fact that I can turn the question into a rhyme.
I try and get on with everyone and I think I'm quite popular just because I'm good fun to go out with.
You know those kids at school that were always like quite cool when they, you know when they bounced a ball when it went into the like bin or they took things behind them? And that was me.
These people had opinions.
I hate chavs with an ungodly passion.
Doesn't make a difference to me whether you're gay, straight or whatever. Not a problem. I'm not gay, therefore I don't want to push it in people's faces. I don't want to see other gay people push it in my face.
Hi!
My mother says she wants me to hook up with one of Fergie's kids. Now, I won't, you know, bad mouth, but not my cup of tea. I don't like redheads.
At the end of the day, despite no one having a clue what they were applying for, some came a lot closer than they could ever have imagined.
Going to the moon is just something I think everyone wants to do. Well, not everyone, but I want to do it.
If I could pick any job, I'd be an astronaut because I'm just really fascinated by space.
I read in the newspaper the other day that for 30 million you can do it, so I need to start saving.
I'd love to be an astronaut, you know, just being held into space.
There's like another world out there, and I'd really like to explore it, but I guess I probably will never do that.
Or will you? Thankfully, they will never make that journey to space. I say thankfully, because let's take a closer look at this shuttle. Yes, from the interior, it appears to be a faithful reproduction of a genuine working space shuttle. But the exterior view is another matter. It's made of wood, and it just wouldn't be safe. You see, even though I don't know a lot about space travel, one thing I do know is that wooden panels have an annoying tendency to burn up on re-entry. OK, we're going to take a break now, but join us in a couple of minutes when we reveal how the use of the most advanced psychological tests and empirical scientific profiling techniques were used to weed out the wrong stuff from the right stuff.
A skull put on top of, like, a lampshade, smiling with a cowboy hat on it.
Welcome back to Space Cadets. Our recruits are actually here right now. It's a bit weird because in the background there you might just hear some quite traditionally English church bells. I hope they can't hear them there. I'm just going to check whether they've heard us using some state-of-the-art surveillance equipment. I only say this because there's quite a lot of us here. I had somebody use some state-of-the-art surveillance equipment to see they haven't heard us. I'm only kidding. That one. We're fine. It's okay. They're playing pool. So, how were the space cadets recruited?
Well, I can tell you. First up, from the hundreds of applicants who wanted in on our mystery mission, we eliminated anyone whose hobby was military bases or space. This included members of Her Majesty's forces, anyone with training in astrophysics or related disciplines, and of course, anyone who could name more than four characters from Star Trek: The Next Generation. With these potentially dangerous know-it-alls out of the frame, we were then ready to start the tests in earnest as we set out to discover who had what we were looking for and who didn't. From the 100 interviewed, we invited 50 potential space cadets to London for a day of psychological tests. Unbeknownst to them, three actors had infiltrated the group. From this point on, Charlie, Rainey and Steve will pose as contenders and be our eyes and ears from within. For this mission to succeed, our space cadets will have to be suggestible. Suggestible people are more likely to believe all that they see and hear. A suggestible mind is also often a highly creative mind. Together with psychologist Professor Robert Edelman, we devised a number of tests to measure the suggestibility of each of our contenders. First up, the dot pattern test. Each contender was shown a series of pattern cards. They were told that some contained hidden faces. They didn't. Those that saw the faces in most detail were the most suggestible. They want to believe in something so much they'll see something that doesn't exist. These are our kind of people. Take a close look at each card. If you can spot something, you too could have the suggestible mind of a space cadet.
Let the dot pattern test begin.
Some saw nothing, ruling them out of the race. But the most suggestible candidates let their imaginations run wild.
That's Boy George.
Loads of different people and they're all just dancing around crazy.
Is that a dog?
A woman's reproductive system.
Maybe just the bottom half of a dolphin.
What the old shipyard workers looked like when they went to work.
Okay, this looks like Mr. Punch.
Oh, it's a witch, a hot dog and some fries.
Looks like an Italian priest with the Joker out of Batman's makeup on.
A skull put on top of like a lampshade, smiling with a cowboy hat on it.
One card, however, did contain a face. A little clue for our unsuspecting space cadets. Can you see what it is yet?
It looks like a Roswell alien.
Alien. Alien.
That's definitely an alien.
Ah, Elvis. About time you showed up.
The second test of suggestibility was based on the marbles in a jar test, devised by a psychologist named Crutchfield in 1964. This test was designed to measure group conformity. During the training, our actors will be on hand to help convince the cadets they may really be blasting off into space. Essential. So we needed to see who was more likely to be influenced by group thinking. The test was simple. We filled a glass jar with rubber eyeballs and asked the contenders to guess how many there were. Each contender was asked to say their first estimate out loud.
My first guess is 60.
Before writing their final guess on a board. However, the producers were sneaky and altered the results of previous candidates to make them unrealistically high. For some, the exaggerated estimates weren't going to sway them.
So give me your first guess.
150.
85.
But those who changed their gut instinct after seeing the numbers on the board were the people for us.
What's your first guess?
70.
Now you have 10 further seconds
mm-hmm.
to write your final guess next to where you see your name.
Is it a bit higher, I think, than everyone else's? 150.
70.
And then write your final guess on the board.
Whoa.
Okay.
87.
103.
And there were some who just didn't get it at all.
What's your first guess?
A load of rubber eyes. Oh.
And if you don't touch the eyes or the jar, if you don't touch the eyes or the jar.
Oh, and just so you know, there were in fact 210 eyeballs. The Finnish shuttle will measure just 10 foot by 8 foot by 8 foot. Each compartment is the same size as your average garden shed, and our cadets will be living in there for up to 5 days. We'd already eliminated those who admitted to being claustrophobic, but we needed to test the rest for ourselves. This included our actors. There are two types of claustrophobia. First, we tested for restrictive claustrophobia with the sleeping bag test. Our successful cadets will be donning genuine Russian cosmonaut spacesuits, complete with close-fitting helmets. So, we made each actor and contender wear a pair of blacked-out goggles before strapping them into a sleeping bag for 20 minutes. The heat, restriction, and extreme sensory deprivation recreated the cramped conditions in the suits. Most people were totally at ease. And while some refused to take it lying down, nobody showed signs of severe restrictive claustrophobia. As if being mummified wasn't difficult enough, we then tested them for confinement claustrophobia in the lift test. Just like at a fairground, rule one of space travel is that once on board, there's no getting off until the ride has come to a complete stop. So, unbeknownst to our contenders and actors, a lift was rigged to break down, trapping them for 20 minutes under the watchful eye of our producers and psychologists.
Oh. It does it again, then we're in trouble.
Oh.
Oh my God! Why is this jolting?
Are we stuck?
We're stuck.
That's great.
Some applicants had a ball.
How many eggs does it take to make a French omelette?
I don't know. How many eggs does it take to make a French
omelette? One, because one egg is enough.
But it wasn't long before some real signs of anxiety started to show.
This is my worst nightmare. It's been stuck in a bloody lift.
We won't run out of oxygen, will we?
It's not the best thing to be stuck in a lift. I always think it's just going to drop something.
Yeah, it's a bit warm.
Can we fan you a bit?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Hot, hot, hot.
Right,
like small spaces.
I can't breathe.
And after clocking the hidden camera, actors Charlie and Rainey made the most of the situation by becoming the annoying lift mate.
I think what you're meant to do is lie flat to spread your pressure.
We're not obviously getting very close to the ground, yeah. So why don't we all bounce?
Yeah, as if you stand up there, you're maximising the pressure.
Right.
So then your legs will pass up through your body cavity.
Jump with me, James! Jump with me!
After 20 minutes, Professor Edelman was able to tell us who could handle being trapped inside a shuttle and who we should discount.
Oh, thank God for that!
After a day of staring at dots, counting rubber eyes, being strapped into sleeping bags and being trapped in a lift, there was one final treat in store. Dancing, blindfolded, in a room full of strangers, in silence. We needed people who could see the funny side of television's most ambitious illusion. So our cadets needed cast iron confidence and the ability to lose their inhibitions. Anyone happy to get down wearing blacked out goggles to no music on camera was perfect. Anyone too shy to disco was out. Space is no place for wallflowers. As a final test of a thick skin, one by one, the dancers were instructed to remove their goggles, leaving one unlucky applicant boogieing alone.
Thank you!
Some more happily than others.
So,
Good, couldn't see a thing. After the break, we'll see how this small corner of England was transformed into a convincing Russian space agency. And after the success of the scientific tests, we see how the space cadets handled the physical examination. Welcome back to Space Cadets, where we've brought a little bit of Russia and a handful of wannabe astronauts to a field reasonably close to the Bird in Hand public house just off the B1438. I'm just talking a bit quietly because the recruits are in the barracks just there and they mustn't hear me. We've got a big crew here. The task was to convert this disused military base into a convincing-looking Russian space camp. Now, this called for the mother of all makeovers and the kind of interior furnishings that even Llewellyn Bowen, at his most insane, wouldn't dream of. Have a look at this. We needed to transform a disused military base into STAR, the Space Tourism Agency of Russia. So we sent our design team to an aircraft dismantler's in the heart of Essex to find some military bric-a-brac to help convince our cadets they're in a Soviet space camp. This yard is one of the major suppliers to the film industry for aircraft and military paraphernalia, ideal for our purposes. Everything on the shopping list was here. Control panels, check. Landing gear, check. Jet parts, check. And of course, missiles, check. These Bloodhound surface-to-air missiles were last used in the film Die Another Day. All that was needed was to remove the English writing and replace it with Russian.
Nice.
This aircraft junk will go a long way to making our base look like the real deal. Next, our team headed out to Moscow for a whistle-stop shopping trip. They needed to buy the kind of comforts that will convince our space cadets they really are in the southwest of Russia. First stop, a hypermarket of Russian proportions. Our team had to go undercover, as the Russian authorities would not allow them to film. They had to buy everything, from fizzy drinks to toiletries.
Three of those and two of them.
Yeah. Matches in the bottle and then we strike them on the back.
10 bars of soap.
Smells minging.
Shampoo, shower gel, toothpaste.
They needed to get enough supplies to last the space cadets the duration of their stay at STAR's training facility. It could be 20 showers a day for 3 weeks. That's a lot of shampoo. Mission accomplished. Next, the team drove 2 hours to the outskirts of Moscow, to a traditional market. Time to bargain hunt, Russian style.
These are very good. That's Baran, the Russian space shuttle, Yuri Gagarin.
The design team needed badges to decorate the uniforms of the Russian soldiers and staff at the space base back in England.
$15.
Cheap as chipskis.
We just got a load of guards and guard kind of officers when they first come in. So we just need to dress quite a few people. Just a couple of items really that we can just keep using. It's good stuff.
They even managed to find some space suits and a rare re-entry compression space helmet. Job done. Back in Blighty, the truck arrived with all the military equipment. This stage is crucial. One detail out of place and the game is up. First in, the missile. The team go to work. Starting with the training building.
In the lecture room, first came the desks, and the Russian keyboards went in. Every single electric socket was changed from English to Russian. Even the plugs had a makeover. To finish it off, Russian signs were placed everywhere with genuine Russian blue tack. As a special touch, an original ejector seat was found for the mission commander's office, which was then jam-packed full of goodies from the trip to Russia. Every detail had to be checked and double-checked. There cannot be a single thing out of place. Every trace of English has to be erased. One small slip-up from the team and the whole thing is blown.
Space travel is no easy thing. American astronauts train for 24 months, Russian cosmonauts train for 36 months. And in here, the lecture room where pretendernauts will train for 20 days. Yes, 20 whole days. But it's not all about boring lessons. Genuine astronauts have to be in peak physical condition. So if our cadets were to believe that they were being selected for a space mission, it was important they should also believe that we tested their physical ability. That's why, along with our three undercover actors, we sent them for a workout to an environment even harsher, starker, and more uninhabitable than anything lurking in the deep extremities of space. Cumbria. It's October, and our remaining 21 contenders are about to experience an adrenaline-fueled 36 hours deep in the heart of the Lake District. We already know they are suggestible and that they're not claustrophobic. Now we need to find out how they'd cope in extreme conditions, in preparation for life on board the shuttle. Our three actors, Rainey, Steve and Charlie, are also in the mix. To be convincing, they'll have to participate in every activity, no matter how tough it is. Before they've even arrived, Charlie's cover story that he's a poet is suddenly put to the test.
So we'll give a poem to the camera. Say a poem. Go on, let me say a poem. I saw a pebble on the beach, and it reminded me of you. Or was it the dog behind, scratching its shit into the cold sand?
Meanwhile, Paul and the boys are bonding on the back seat. 6 hours later, our cadets arrive at the activity centre and get a good night's sleep in preparation for the day ahead. It's 7 a.m. and our would-be astronauts have been sent orienteering.
We should be near a railway.
They quickly adapt to the outdoor life.
Yeah, northeast, just in case you're wondering, aren't we? Yeah, northeast.
And some even start to enjoy it.
I hope we get lost because it's beautiful up here.
I'm happy. She's happy. We're all happy.
Except for actor Charlie.
I'm close to the edge. I don't think I can take life with these people for very much longer.
But while Charlie's problems are in his mind, fellow actor Steve's are physical.
Wait, 2 minutes.
Oh, I just popped my foot down wrong.
Probably, it'll clean you up.
Be all right, it'll be better in a minute.
It'll cure your foot and mouth.
Come on, Steve-o!
Basically, they've all rushed up to the top, but I'm just absolutely shagged out. I'm just not used to this type of exercise at all.
It's a bloody big mountain!
So I'm just going to wait here.
Tough.
Get my agent on the phone. I didn't agree to do this. They're not paying me enough.
Despite his financial misgivings, Steve struggles manfully on.
Remember me for the BAFTAs.
It's midday, and our platoon has been split into two for a test of nerves. The task for some? Abseiling down a 90-foot sheer rock face. Wake up, Steve! Fellow actor Charlie is equally enthusiastic.
If you asked any of my friends right now what I'd be doing average Saturday, they'd say, well, he's probably up a Cumbrian mountain about to throw himself off a fucking cliff in the name of so-called entertainment. That's probably what they'd say. And they'd be right.
That's it, Charlie. Go on, man. Good. Good skills.
Fucking hell.
Next over the edge is Cheryl.
Really, really nervous. Really, really nervous. It's going to take a lot for me to get down this cliff.
Well done, Shaz. You're doing really well.
Once I get going, I was all right. If I can do that, I can do anything.
After conquering the mountain of getting his hair into the helmet, Ryan's off.
I was terrified up top, and then once I got going, it was really thrilling. And then I got a bit bold towards the end.
Nice moves, Ryan, but Louise impressed the instructors more.
Great, well done, well done.
She said she'd never done that before, but I'm not quite sure.
Off she goes.
Well done, Lou, that's well done. That's the best so far.
Peasy peasy, really easy peasy.
Tell that to Steve, Louise.
I don't think I've been this scared in a very, very long time. I feel absolutely petrified. My arms are feeling really weak at the moment. Fuck me.
Wow!
He just fell over to one side. He's in a nice seating position there. Looks like he sat on the toilet.
That was probably one of the most scariest experiences I've ever had in my entire life.
Try and keep your heels on the box face, Steve, that's it.
The rope just seemed to be slipping through my gloves a little bit and I was coming down a little bit too fast than I wanted to and the rock was scared, was slippery and... Oh, God. But I could certainly do with a lie down and a nice cup of cocoa.
Meanwhile, the rest of the group had an even greater test of their fear. A 30-foot bridge jump. The prospect of going to space is a scary thing, so we need to see if they can conquer their fears.
I am going to do it. I'm going to try.
I've been waiting for something decent to do.
Isn't this show worth it? I'm getting freezing every day. Fucking...
Fucking better, me.
It's like cold seekers. Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
But Kerry seems worried, and Freddie's stomach's doing all kinds of stuff. Actor Rainey steps up first.
I saw what we were doing, and I thought, you bastards, I can't believe you're actually making us do this. And I thought, I have to go first, because it's one of those things, if you stand up there for too long, you'll psych yourself out and you won't do it. I've never done a job like this before in my life. It was great, I'm having a ball.
Are Kerry and Freddie brave enough to follow?
I'm like 50% that I'm going to do it, 50% that I'm not.
We're all scared, Freddie. We just have to stick together to support each other.
One small step for Andrew. One giant leap for Kerry.
I've never even jumped in the swimming pool. I always like step on the side and just kind of like go gently in. Oh my God, I can't. You can.
Kerry's done it, now it's Freddie's turn.
Freddie, you want me down there?
Down there, don't worry, down there.
I'm so proud, I can't stop grinning. I'm really, really proud of myself. That was a feat, I think. You can throw anything else you like at me now. I will do it, no fear at all.
Fuck, that's the worst thing I've ever done in my life.
What's wrong with the girls? They're scared by a bit of water. Come on, Dennis, show them how it's done.
Oh my God!
It's 7 p.m. It's raining, and our soggy contenders now have to canoe to their campsite. But they're a man down. Guess who?
I'm feeling cold, and I'm feeling sick. That's basically it in a nutshell.
The rest of the group soldier on.
Well, we can't really get to grips with the whole canoeing thing. Why do we keep getting away? Right, back home. We hate the water. My feet are full of water.
Do you want to sit on the water if I do?
Well, as you can see, me and Kevin are doing pretty well. We're going that way. Yeah? And we'll get there.
I've got a vest, t-shirt, woolly fleece, combat jacket, this waterproof on. No heat's getting out, but I'm still cold.
Shit! Oh, look at a turn!
We won!
That's parking for you.
Bugger.
Oh, that's not good.
It's time for our weary soldiers to set up camp. Even Steve's made it to the campsite, determined to battle through the pain.
I'm still feeling rough, but I'm trying to fight through it tonight. I don't know how to set up the ground sheet, so we need to get that sorted out soon, because I don't really fancy sleeping on wet grass. Otherwise I'm going to have a cold bath.
And so our thrill seekers have made it. As the others sleep, the lads gaze up at the night sky, and the conversation takes an unexpected but spookily relevant turn.
And really, if you keep on looking and you really look for a few minutes, just keep your eyes on it, you get more and more stars coming to it, and they should be like inches away. Beautiful.
The North Star's over there.
And Seven Sisters on the left of it.
And you've got three satellites up there.
Yeah.
And Mars is over there.
Is Mars over there?
Yeah, somewhere.
20 million that guy paid a few
Everyone paid 3 million.
20 million, he went up there and talked about how great the food was.
Don't you just want to get on a spaceship and go up there and just find out for yourself?
Oh, it'd be lovely, wouldn't it?
I'd like to do something that no one else, well, a few people have ever done. That's what I'd like to do.
This is the Mission Commander's office, and this, of course, is the Mission Commander's ejector seat chair. And in the top drawer of the Mission Commander's desk is... Oh, my God, that's absolute filth. In the next drawer down is... How did he fit that in there? That's illegal, isn't it? Where are the confidential cadet files? All right. I've got them. 12 files, one for each of our cadets. Whose names are on them, and how excited were they when they found out they'd been selected to join a Russian space tourist program? All will be declassified right after the break. You are about to become the very first televised British space tourist. Welcome back to Space Cadets. So far, we've transformed a disused airbase near Ipswich to appear like an authentic Russian space training camp, right down to the freezing breath. Applicants have been rigorously tested for their suitability for the most ridiculous adventure in the history of space travel. Of course, if you're a cadet, it's otherwise known as a five-day mission to orbit the Earth, or so they think. Of course, none of the applicants knew what they're applying for. So how would they react when the time came to name the lucky nine who would join our three undercover actors and go down in history as part of Britain's first televised space tourism programme? Well, this is one of the questions we had to ask their friends and families. During the course of their interviews, we asked all the applicants to nominate someone they trusted implicitly to make a decision on their behalf. Now, once our contestants were in isolation, we travelled the length and breadth of the country to talk to these friends and family. We explained the precise concept of the show, nothing held back at all. And then we asked their permission to involve their loved ones. Without exception, we were given the green light. So all that remained to be done was for me to tell the lucky nine exactly what they'd let themselves in for. November, Biggin Hill Airport, Kent. The producers have chosen their final nine thrill seekers. They've been isolated in separate secret locations for almost 2 weeks and check in at the airport, hiding their faces from the press. As before, actors Rainey, Steve and Charlie are blending in a treat. From the hundreds of applicants who applied, the final cadets are Andrew, Astrid, Billy, actor Charlie, Cheryl, Kerry, Louise, Paul, actor Rainey, Ryan, Sarah Jane, and actor Steve. They're finally about to discover what the show is all about. Well, almost.
All right, gang. OK. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to what promises to be quite a night for all of you. Back in June, you know, you all applied for a show called Thrill Seekers. Throughout the last 5 months, you've had no idea what that show was, correct? Yes. Absolutely no idea whatsoever. OK. Now, you were promised a challenge and the ultimate thrill. That's what you were promised, yeah?
Yes.
Listen very carefully. I'm now going to give you the big picture. You are about to become the first televised British space tourists. That's right. Let's just go through that again. You can take it in. The very first televised British space tourists. Okay. This plane here, it will take you to Russia. Once there, you will undergo 3 weeks of intensive astronaut training with STAR, the Space Tourism Agency of Russia. You may have seen when billionaires go up into space, they're the boys they use. At the end of your training, a lucky few, the best of the best, will be sent into orbit on a 5-day space tourist mission. This will not be all of you. You're the 12 who've made the cut to go to STAR, okay? And it will all be televised here in the UK. Okay, now the producers believe you have what it takes. And they hope you'll continue this adventure by boarding this jet behind me. But you don't have to. I'm going to give you 1 minute now. Really think very carefully about this. Your minute is up. So I'm now going to ask each one of you in turn whether you're going to take on this challenge. So, Andrew, would you like the chance to go into space?
Yeah!
OK, oh, Astrid, mate. Would you like the chance?
Astrid, not! Astrid!
Billy, soul. Charlie?
Yes.
Cheryl?
Yes!
Kerry, would you like the chance to go into space?
Beam me up, Johnny, beam me up.
Louise, would you like the chance to
yes,
go into space?
Please.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Paul.
Let's do it, John.
Rainey, would you like the chance to go into space?
Uranus, here we come.
Ryan.
Johnny, we love you. Take us to space.
Sarah Jane.
I'd absolutely love the chance, Johnny.
I'm finishing up with Steve.
Oh, try and stop me from getting on that plane.
Okay. You may now board your plane and off you pop. On you get, John. On you get. Go. On you get, gang. On you get, gang. On you get. On you get. Yes. Yes. I've had a look at the snacks on board. They're not too good. Things are going to be a bit low budget from now on, but there you go. Take care, take care, take care. On you get. Hey! And so our cadets board the plane to start their epic journey from Kent to somewhere near Ipswich.
In on a jet plane, I don't know when I'll be back again. See you again. On a jet plane, I don't know when I'll be back again. On a jet plane, I don't know when I'll be back again.
Leaving on a jet plane.
So, no problems getting them on the plane, and they seem to swallow the story. But with 4 hours thinking time flying round and round the North Sea, would they still be buying it when they touched down and a small slice of Suffolk was presented to them as a Russian space cap? I mean, put yourselves in their position. Would you fall for it if this man greeted you off the plane?
Welcome to Russian military space base Krimsk. You go to bus. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Convinced me, but what about them? Find out tomorrow night on Space Cadets.
And that's at 9, and E4 has its satellite show starting in just a moment. Next tonight, one of the passengers makes an important find in Lost.